you can expect the pirates to be anywhere, because they are in those fishing vessels, and these fishing vessels go anywhere, you know. I mean, there is no stopping them.
It's been 1.5 years and we are still hoping. Hope is the only thing which has brought us this far.
Somebody has to pay for the life of the seafarer.
Nooramoon is for a ship work between Dubai and Somalia. Have general cargo. My crew come from India, some from Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Syria, and sometime in other country. I am the father of the crew, it's normal. In age and in work also.
My vessel's name is Sabina Kirin. It was a crude oil carrier. We had got loaded in Sudan and it was heading towards Malaysia. There are 22 people on board. Out of that, 17 people were Indians and 5 were Italians.
We are around 500 nautical miles away from the Indian coast. That was the time and there was an immediately announcement made that pirate boat detected. They started firing with AK-47s and grenade launchers. And we could hear the sounds even in the engine room.
The accommodation were filled with smoke and fire alarm was ringing. A lot of things were happening, banging, booming sounds were there.
The attack lasted for around 2-2.5 hours because at 10:30 they were on board.
And they were firing, were shouting, like they were happy.
They were not bothered if they killed one person, because they used to say if the company is going to give money for 22 people, it will give money for 21 people also. So even one or two people die, it makes no difference.
MV Albedo has been hijacked for the past 18 months. It's a Malaysian ship with 23 crew members, out of which one has already died. My father is the captain of the ship. He's been a seafarer for 40 years. He was 18 when he first joined and he's 62 now. And yes, this was supposed to be his last voyage before his retirement. It took one entire year of negotiations for us to come down to an amount of $2.85 million. So that was the first step, and then the second step was to figure out how to collect this money. We learned that the owner is not in the position to be able to pay such a huge amount, and the company had gone bankrupt. So pretty much after some months, we had to, instead of depending on the owner, we decided that we have to do something as his daughters and my mother as his wife.
For the last 7 months, we were given 1 liter of water, 1 bottle of water per day, fresh water. You want to wash your face, you want to drink, you want to do washing, you want to do anything. You have 1 liter of water, that's all.
We are not able to take bath, we are not able to cut our hair, not even able to shave for nearly 8 months, I think.
For 11 months, I had not spoken with my daughter. I had not spoken to my parents also. I did not know how everybody is.
We felt completely isolated, whether it was from the ship owners or whether it was from the governments of the other nationalities who were on board the ship. So we were completely isolated for a very long time. We started this campaign called Save MV Albedo, Save My Father's Life. And in that campaign, we used social media. We did on-ground activities. I remember going to events and going on stage and just begging people to donate, even if it's 10 rupees, even if it's 100 rupees, every penny counts for us at this point, because I need to save my father or he's going to die there.
I was not able to know what is happening at home. I was not able to know what has happened to my wife.
I can't sleep in the night and I went for some psychiatrist. Don't know what to happen to me.
All the Somalis, they grabbed us and they tied us also. And we were in that tied up position for around 1 hour. And we could not feel our hands and legs. We could hardly breathe in that position, I'll tell you. It was like we were praying to God. I could hear Chief Engineers crying and I could hear him. But it was such a mental, my mental state had gone for a toss, I'll say.
Yeah, I already prepared
the route from here. The route is very, very dangerous. Dangerous because the pirates, they have arm. And the ships don't have anything, only the seawater for defense. The small boat skiff, you don't know if the piracy or fishing ship.
They hit me with a handle of the axe, a long axe. They hit me on the nose and I was bleeding from my nose. I hit me on the face also. They kicked us a lot. They hit us with the butt of the guns and it was like we see in the movies. They tortured the chief engineer really bad at that point. They were trying to pull his fingernails with a plier. And there were one person was continuously hitting him on the back with an iron rod. It was like a bad dream and we were just waiting for the bad dream to get over with and one day we are going to be home, everything, all normal life.
Then I got a chance to call after severely torturing us, severely beating. I got severe beating. At that time I got a chance to call and I was crying to my wife telling that please help me to get out of this place.
We didn't know if we were going to be able to raise that amount, but we have had to still keep trying. So we did try even till the date of the deadline.
And I could not afford to give up, you know, because this was a matter of 22 lives. And if we gave up at this point, then what is going to happen? We can't just leave them to just perish.
The lowest point for me was when they had declared that they will be executing myself and the chief officer. They declared it at 8 o'clock at night that tomorrow second engineer and chief officer will be shot dead.
We'd only raised 10% of the amount, and with 90% still to go of the portion that we were supposed to raise.
It made us realize that we can only do so much in our capacity. No matter how hard we try, there is always a limit there. We can't exceed that limit.
Even on the day of the deadline, we were hoping for a miracle within the last hours of the day. My sister, she went on a national television and we reached somebody's heart who was kind enough to donate the remaining amount. So we've done our part and miraculously, whatever we had committed to raise, we've been able to raise that. But the release of the ship still depends on the owner of the ship and whether or not the rest of the money can be arranged.
It makes you realize the power of money.
And the power of individuals who can make such a huge difference. And even life and death depends on individuals who can help and make a difference.
Every day I see in the mirror, I see the scar on my nose and it reminds me of what I had been through in Somalia. Before I was a very carefree person, but now I care for life more than before.
We ordinary people can't do much no matter how hard we try. You know, begging on the roads, going to people, knocking on every door, it's not going to make a difference. It's just like a drop in the ocean unless somebody in power steps forward.
Unless and until something comes in black and white and it is approved and enforced, these things will continue. The life of seafarers are important and they should realize this. It is more important than the cargo, the ship and everything.
It's our life. We work and life in the sea. We can't stop. We will continue.
I would never want any daughter, any son, any brother, any mother to go through what we did, because it is one of the most horrifying experiences that anybody can ever go through. Those that can do something about this need to have a solution. There should be a long-term solution that so that people stop suffering. I would like to tell my father that even now that you've come this far, I would not want you to lose hope. We're waiting every day, every hour for your return, and we're not giving up on you, and we will never give up on you till you actually reach home. So please just don't lose hope and hang in there.